together of the Sydney Harbour Bridge. Of course, they built it from each side, joined up in the middle. Before my time, but this must have been quite an interesting morning when this fellow, the group, rode his horse and cut the ribbon. He was arrested immediately after. Yeah, it's a bit different today. With someone like him today, couldn't they? Yeah. Worth circus? Most of us have been, I think, to see all the of those. Worth for running circuses. This is Sydney. Yeah, they got pretty close to the Sydney Harbour. Close to the midget submarine, yeah. Unfortunately, David's missing that.
Oh.
But David's just gone out.
Mm.
We might hold that for a minute. David's grandfather could even be there. He was a great friend of John Curtin's.
Oh, really?
And in fact, David showed me a photo.
Mm-hmm.
This could be. Not sure which one's Curtin. This one. I mean, so this could be David's grandfather. He might be the same photo as he showed me on last weekend, his grandfather with John Curtin. Oh no, it's Duffy Evans, so that's Curtin on the other side. I think that's still unsolved, the Wanda Beach murders. Fitzroy. He was a great runner and first Aboriginal member of Parliament. Pastor Dave Nicholls. This is the gravel bridge, train slash. Yeah, bridge. No, it's Sydney. Sydney. Roger, is it possible you could go back to that photo for David's benefit?
Oh, yeah.
Is that possible?
Yeah.
If you could quickly.
Your photos, Jerry.
Sorry?
Your photos.
Well, they were sent to me as an email, and because we were looking for just something to pull in a bit of time. Yeah, a friend of mine sent them to me. Where he got them from, I don't know. It's obviously something you can pick up off the internet. But there's a photo. That was it, I think.
That's it.
David, you showed me a photo on Saturday.
That's right.
John Curtin. And your grandfather.
My grandfather was a tall bearer, got to the student of Karakata, and he's a drinking partner.
He's not there.
No, not
in that photo.
No, not
there. Oh, I thought it might have been the same photo that you showed me.
I've got a photo of him addressing the Geneva Conference in 1940s, I think, to bring it along.
Okay, thanks. Thanks, Roger. So that was just a slideshow that a friend had sent me, and I thought, oh, well, they're interesting photos. And there is another short one, a slideshow on some, I think, maybe West Australian historic photos. You can see that. Oh, that of course is the Maylands Hotel. Are you going to do this one now?
If you like.
Okay. Just hold on there for a minute. As a result of that photo that appeared in the West Australian, we received a call from a fellow called Peter Denshaw. Vera received the call and he said, look, so ring me and have a chat with me. So I talked to this chap, David Denshaw, his name is pronounced, but he was a grand nephew of Murray Hoffman. Now, Murray Hoffman didn't build this hotel. I think in our minutes we see he built it. He didn't build the hotel. That was the first hotel in Guildford Road in Maylands, the Maylands Hotel. Well, some say as early as 1902, but I think we've recorded 1906. And in street directories, I think it says 1906. think, Vern Wheatley.
While you still look at it, I don't think so.
Yep.
I'd like to point out the horse trot there just in front of the pain.
Yeah.
Carnals. That horse trot is in front of nearly every hotel that was around the districts.
So yeah, and later on.
I've done a bit of a history on all the horse trots.
Yeah, well, there were, you know, there were a few horse trots around Maylands. Of course, that was the order of the day, horse and cart. The hotel was built, and in our first records of street directories, there was a fellow called Wheatley was the licensee of that hotel. It's on the corner of Roland Street, which is now vacant land, really. It's in fact, it's opposite Coles, where the...
Is there a copy of that, isn't there?
Yes, please. Yeah, there's a copy of it. In fact, the Hoffman family gave this to the Batty Library. It's available from the Batty Library, but we've also got a copy of that photo up at the police station. But then, so when Peter Gentle rang, he asked me to talk to his cousin, a girl called Sandy Kerr. Sandy lives in Denmark, and she grew up. She had another photo. She was a granddaughter of Maury Hoffman. And Maury, when he bought the hotel in 1930, he renovated the hotel, and people, you know, were a bit disappointed because it looked pretty good. It would still look pretty good today if it was like that. But he bought it around, and maybe you've got another photo where... No, there's one earlier, probably. That one of Peter Rowan's drawings. Well, that's the Maylands Hotel that Maury Hoffman renovated. Well, I thought the hotel was knocked down and rebuilt, but in fact it wasn't like that at all. He renovated that original building and it became this building. And through the series of emails that were going backwards and forwards, there was, first of all, was Peter Denschel. Then he referred me to Sandy Kerr, who was granddaughter. She told me to talk to David Hoffman, who had some photos. And David suggested I talk to his cousin, Diane, who was a Hoffman as well. And so we're talking to Sandy, David, Diane, and Peter, their cousin. And they all had, you know, an odd photo of the hotel. So we've gathered all that material together. And Roger will probably go through and show us the other one. But that's the hotel now. You'll notice in our boardroom, Peter, we've got up at the police station, we've got a watercolour by Peter Rowan, who lived next door to Frank Greenslade. And when Peter died, Peter was a very, very fine artist. And when he died, his wife had all this material that Peter had kept over the years, and she donated it all. Well, she gave it to Frank, who passed it on to us. So we were very fortunate to obtain this material. So this photo is almost identical to the watercolour that we've got hanging in our boardroom. It's just a little bit different. But as you can see, there was a shell garage. Now this is on the corner of Roland Street, which is about here, and Guildford Road. It's an opposite Coles, or opposite IGA, I guess. IGA is over here.
Keith. That's the original. Maurie Hoffman in 1930 did that renovation. And we've got some photos of so this is where he's doing the changes to the building. There's a sign there that reads business as usual, so it didn't stop them operating while they did the work on the renovation.
What's the sort of the other photographs? The
So that's a sketch of Peter Rowan, and you can see, you know, it's very close to an actual photo of and they knew now this is Maurice Hoffman. This is Maurice Hoffman as a younger man in Russia. He came from Russia, and I'm not sure who the fellow with him is, they haven't said, but this was Maurice Hoffman. He arrived in Perth with very, very little money, and he never read or wrote. He was never taught to read or write, but he knew how to make money. And he owned that hotel freehold, and I think he was the Morris Hotel in Scarborough. I think he owned that hotel as well. So. Couldn't read or write, he could sign his name, and that's about all he could do. And this is he and his wife, Millie, I think her name was. But he was very well known in Maylands, and we probably haven't got one of something else, but I'll talk about that later. Now, most of you know, or some of you have remember the Roxy Gardens, a theatre in Guildford Road, Maylands, where on the corner of Falkirk, where Coles supermarket now is. But this is the screen, and this is the open air gardens. There were like bench seats down each side, and what do they call them? Peck chairs in the centre. And I think, I can't read that from here, but I think the film they're advertising is she married a cop, I think, and it's sixpence to get in. But this was taken by David Hoffman's father, Jaime, and I think the photo will be in a new book that Kathy May is doing for the city of Bayswater, if she wanted to put that photo of the Roxy Theatre, because it was just fortunate because we didn't have anything on the Roxy Theatre. You know, most of us who lived in Maylands went there, but we had no record of it. And Judith's nodding her head, yeah, she went there. And all us kids would go to the Roxy during the summer months. The Robinsons, who owned the Lyric, owned both theatres, and you know there were times when it would rain and everybody would move up to the Lyric in 8th Avenue, in the centre of 8th Avenue, which is now the BWS liquor store. But you know, there'd just be a route march up to the other theatre if it rained, which sometimes would happen in the summer.
But what year?
Pardon?
What year? Year.
Oh, well, all I can tell you, Colin, is when we went there as kids, you know, probably in the 1940s, 50s, around those years, there was a bus company, well, Bassendean Bus Company, that used to run between Perth and Bassendean. And I would venture to say that was one of the Bassendean Bus Company buses. But it was taken off the balcony of the Maylands Hotel. So one of the Hoffman nephews actually took the photo of that. So we're very lucky to have a photo of the rocks of which we didn't have a record of before. So that's really terrific. There's a bit of a story about Murray Hoffman there. It's very hard to read, but there's a tribute to him in one of the local papers. He did a lot of good work in Maylands, and he was well known and well respected too. Now this is the rear of the hotel, and they're doing some work there, and there's another photo. So that was him. And this is doing the renovations at the hotel. Changed it from a fine old building that it was to something not so grand, I think. But anyway. But this is a photo of the beer garden at the back of the hotel where we see them doing some clearing. But the Hoffman family tell me that this was the first beer garden in Western Australia. So, and we're lucky now we've got a photo of that. So it's terrific. And I understand from one of the grandsons, David Hoffman, that he has some other photos that he's working, so he hasn't been to the police station yet. But when he comes, he's going to bring some other material that we might be able to use as well. So just from that little photo in the paper, this is one of the stories. There was a photo of John Gorton talking to somebody, and there's John Gorton talking to Murray later on when he was in a nursing home. There's a photo of the girl who sent me this one. One of the girls said this was what she called a charabanc. It looks like a bit of agricultural machinery or something like that. But Murray Hoffman ventured out of it and he began a bus service from Northern to York. And she said this was the vehicle that he was using to transport people from Northern to York. That's what she called it. She called it the charabanc. That was his one of the things he did, and they were doing some repairs to it. So that's the only information I've got on it. And it certainly doesn't look like a vehicle that you've used. Now this is a copy of a banknote that he left Russia with obviously before 1898. And that particular banknote now is in a museum in Tel Aviv. Some of the story, but he was quite a character, and at one stage in Maylands, when I was a boy, there was a police boys club. It used to operate on Monday nights in the town hall, and they had a competition with three well-known identities in Maylands, and Murray Hoffman was one. There were two other gentlemen. I don't know how long this event ran, but it was to raise money for the local police boys club. And he raised £870-odd. I think the other two, somewhere less than £500. But anyway, he was awarded a baton, inscribed baton, with an inscription on it to say that he'd been awarded this for raising the money for the police boys club in Maylands. We used the hall, they had all sorts of gymnastic equipment, you know, springboard, boards and mats and boxing, they had a boxing ring. All the kids were taught boxing in those days. And there were seven policemen at the Maylands station in those days, and two or three of them would be there with the kids on a Monday night. It's pretty they don't have something like that for young people now, but Maylands Town Hall was packed in those days. This is, when I was probably about 10 to 14, 15, 16, around those years, and there were just hundreds, maybe 100.
You had to be 21 by the time. So you joined the police force.
We're all much younger than that. So that's pretty much the story of the Hoffman family, who are sort of in contact with us now in a group with all the... One girl in Brisbane, one girl in Sydney. And the girl in Sydney, she came over to Perth 2 weeks ago, came to the police station, and she brought the photos of she called the bat. That's the photo that appeared in the paper. And so I've got a list of, you know, I've got to borrow Margaret's glasses to read the rest of it.
I believe the original photo was in 1908.
Sorry?
The original
photo,
the original police station was in 1908.
It was.
Yeah.
This police station opened in 1908, but they sent a policeman to Maylands in 1906. His name was Ullman. And he operated out of a shop in the middle of 8th Avenue for 2 years. In fact, he didn't live at this place. He lived there, and his wife, when he became a police officer at Maylands, she opened some sort of a shop. I don't know where it was. Probably be able to find that. But she operated the shop in what was the police station in 1906 for 2 years. And then the police station was built in 1908, and so he moved into the police station. Although, as I said, he didn't live there. I don't know who did, because he still lived in 8th Avenue for a number of years. And as I say, his wife operated a shop from there.
John Watts was in that police station too.
John K. Watts would have been there. There were a number of people will remember the name Watts. They had a produce store in 8th Avenue next to the old bakery. The grandparents had the produce company. The boys, four boys, I think they're all in the police force, and mainly in the mounted police. And their sons, one is John K. Watts, who joined the police force too and probably spent some time at Maylands. In fact, he lived down on Peninsula Road in Maylands in those days, when he was early days, just a young policeman and playing for East Perth Footy Club. But another one of the Watts sons, his son was Bob Watts, and probably Judith might remember Bobby Watts. Do you remember Bob? No, I don't remember Bob. Bob finished up as superintendent in the police force, but always to do with the horses. The family having the produce company, somehow they were always involved with horses. And, I've spoken to Bob Watts recently, and Bob is trying to get... We have nothing on the Watts business, the produce store in 8th Avenue. And Bob is trying to get from the family any photos that are relevant. John K. Watts is not very well at all, and talked about, and it's a talk at one stage here, but he's not well enough to do anything, I understand, at this time. So, but Bob I'll ask him to give us a talk, whether he should have given us a talk or not. I know people say it would be great if he could give us a talk. You know, you grew up in Maylands, you did all the things that people do, and we always like to get a bit of input from them. So he said, oh, well, I'll see what I can do. I'll try and rake up some photos, and if he does come back, and I'm sure he will. When, I don't know, but can't put too much pressure on people when you ask them to break up photos and come and give us a talk, but I'm sure he'll come back. I played footy with him when we were boys together, and we had a great long chat, and I'm sure he'll do do what he said he would do. So, what else have we got, Roger? All right. So when we had the street festival, there were a couple of people came up from 8th Avenue who had lived in Maylands, and one was a fellow called Milton Ward. And Milton Ward was from a family who lived in Charles Street, which is just along the railway, what a present, Caledonian, Ferguson, Charles Street. The Wards lived there, and he was terribly impressed with some of the old photos. You know, he grew up and remembered many of the buildings and stuff we had on the display boards there. And he subsequently sent us some photos of the kids at the Maylands Primary School when he was there, his class, and some of his family in their school photos. And he was also involved in the Boy Scouts, so he had photos of Boy Scouts at that time. And he had a photo of Mr. and Mrs. Coombs. Now, Coombs was the station master at Maylands, and his son was Nugget Coombs, who was governor of the Reserve Bank. And they were friends of Milton's parents. And his father worked for H.B. McKay and Massey Harris, which later became Massey Ferguson, which is where what we call Falco Park is now, formerly the original Meth and Ferguson Foundry, as they called it. Well, it wasn't a foundry, but they manufactured most of the pipes, at least half of the pipes for the Eastern Gold Fields and water supply. So that, after the they finished manufacturing the pipes, it eventually became H.B. McKay and Massey Harris. And they, of course, were a Victorian company who made agricultural machinery. And Milton's father and his uncle worked there, and so he has photos of most of the staff who worked for Massey Harris in those early days. So that was good. We were able to get that information from him. When Pam left school, she went to work. She lived in Ferguson Street, and she walked over to RE Arms, which is now Ross's Solvies, where we sell computers and that sort of thing. And she knocked on the door and asked, you know, did they have a job for an office girl? And Dick Arnold, who owned that business, was a very large sheet metal work business in Perth in those years. Talking early 40s, 1941, something like that. And, 48 probably. And Dick Arnold must have taken a bit of a shine to her. She wasn't bad at putting those things. She's not too bad now. Oh, anyway, he said, look, I'd love to give you a job, but he said, I just haven't got a position. But he said, I'll take you down and introduce you to Barney Anderson, who owned the timber and joinery works next door, on the corner of 10th Avenue, which also probably most of you remember lately as Ross's hardware store. So he took Pam down and introduced her to Barney Anderson, and he gave her a job. So while Pam was there, Barney Anderson had some young children, and Pam used to at times look after this young lady, Julie Aitken. She's now Julie Aitken, was Julie Anderson. And her father purchased that timber and hardware business in 1949. So it must have been just after he started, 1949, that you got the job there. And he bought that business from a fellow called General Constructions. And they, there's quite a bit of history attached to that particular building. I'll start the other way around. In 1904, there was a fellow called L.R. Honey. He opened up that business as a timber yard. He called it the Lion Timber Yard, in fact, in 1904. And then later on, he was joined by a partner called Port, and it became known as Port and Honey Timber Company. And then later on, well, that was about 1909, and in 1928, that timber company burned down. And we've got a report from the fire brigade that it was probably the, well, certainly at that time, but there's been a bigger fire in Moylands than that. It created a lot of interest right through Perth. Obviously, it was seen from a long way away. All timber and... anyway, they sort of recovered, and they kept operating the business until later on it was sold to a fellow called Graham Lister. So it was Honey, you know, Lion Timber Company, then Port and Honey, and then Port took it over from Honey and it became Port Timber Company. Burnt down, he kept running it until about 38, I think, and he sold it to a fellow called Graham Lister, who established a joinery works. It was quite a substantial joinery business. And Barney Anderson, whose father lived in Caledonian Avenue, was one of the, when there was about 20 names in Mailing, Barney Anderson's father was one of those listed in the 30. 1901 first street directories. Bernard Anderson lived in Caledonian Avenue, and Barney, his son, owned a house in later on, of course, in Caledonian Avenue as well. Bought this business. He was managing for Claude de Bernalis. He was managing the Hampton Timber Company in Wellington Street in the city. And De Bernalis said this place in Maylands was for sale and he should try and rake up some money and buy it, which he did in 1949. And that's about when Pam went to work for him. So anyway, he operated that business, and as I said, it was a substantial joinery works. And I know our joinery for our house came from there. Most of the builders were using the joinery wooden door frames and window frames and all that out of that business in Tent on the corner of 10th Avenue. The building's still there. So Julie came out and brought some photos, and we have a good photo of Anderson's Timber and Hardware on the boards down at the police station. And what else? So eventually he sold to Douglas Jones, who were quite a large timber company in Perth. They had a big, in Guildford they had quite a big yard. They also had a yard in Perth, and they bought this place here, and after a few years they closed the town, and it did nothing for quite a while. And eventually Ross and Selvidge bought it. So there was quite a history attached to that building on the corner of 10th Avenue, which is still there. So then another girl who Pam had gone to school with was in the same class. She came and told us all about when she worked for a company called Gramac. Gramac made waterproof rubber coated material. Before plastics, it was rubber, sort of canvas, and overcoats and raincoats and everything were made out of this rubberized material. And they made top coats for the police force and the army, and all the defence forces had these rubberized coats. And Jill Lachlan, who lived on the railway line in Railway Parade, she told us all about how, I think there were about 60 girls working in this Bramac factory in Albany Bell Castle, after, of course, Albany Bell had closed down this business. And, you know, there's quite a bit of history attached to that building, as well as Albany Bell in his confectionery and so on, after he closed down. But Jill told us a funny little story. She said when the girls were up to a bit of mischief, they'd lower a string down. The Bramac was on the second floor, and Gibson's confectionery, their four brothers manufacturing lollies, they were in the ground floor. And the girls used to drop a string down, and these young guys would tie a lolly on the string and pull it up. She said eventually they got cheeky and they used to lower quite a sizable bag down. And the boys were a bit keen probably on the girls, and they used to fill the bag up and then pull a bag full of lollies up. But yeah, so that was a funny little story came out of Bramac. Bramac's moved from out of Albany Bell, and they built a new factory in Kenilworth Street in Maylands. And later on, there was a fellow came to visit us through the photo in the west, and I'll mention him a bit later, but he told us all about the Bramac factory in Kenilworth Street. Yeah, of course, the Albany Bell building eventually became the Department of Civil Aviation Workshop. Probably some will remember when they were there. There was a macaroni factory in there. There was Vincent Gibson confectionery. Okay. So we've had a few visits from Kathy May, who's rewriting the book Changes I've Seen, City of Bayswater's book on mainly the history of Bayswater, but since Maylands has become part of Bayswater, they decided to rewrite the book and include history of Maylands. So we've had Kathy on our doorstep every Wednesday, and we've provided her with lots of information and corrected all the stuff she'd been given that was wrong. Thank goodness we got to it before she went to print. But anyway, she mentioned, did I ever know that there was somebody had told her that there was somebody making a fountain pen in Maylands, a company set up making fountain pens. And I knew the guy, and I had one of these particular pens. It was called the Javelin Fountain Pen. Don Carson was a friend of ours. He was a jeweller at Levinson's, and he and his partner in business, I can't give you his surname, Peter, they set up a little free making fountain pens in Maylands. And the only thing, they were a beautiful pen, they were very similar to a Parker pen, an ink pen, you know, with like a bladder, like a fountain pen. They were doing, but unfortunately Mr. Bick came along with a ballpoint pen, and their business sort of went by the board, so it didn't continue. But for a number of years they ran this little company making very, very lovely fountain pens in Maylands. Okay. David, they were over the north side of the line, and they were operating out of somebody else's backyard, virtually a shed in their backyard. So there was a girl called Nancy Bailey rang. This is following up from the little advert that's in the paper. And she hasn't been to see us yet, but she grew up in Inglewood, in fact, and she went to school with Pam, some high school, and she's run several times. She's doing some work, quite important work, with the government department. She's getting close to 80, but she's still working. What's the... Yeah, I forget what she's doing, but anyway, she's...
Something to do with old people's health.
Oh, okay. Elderly. Something to do with health.
Oh,
anyway, she's quite up, but as soon as she gets a break, she's coming out. She wants to see some of the old stuff that we've got on the boards at Mayland. And the next one was a girl called Irene Rosnarkis. And she... It's not ancient history, but she was involved in a group that operated at the Venville Centre, and they were in a fitness group. And she and a friend came and they brought us a lot of photos that we now have in a file of when this fitness group operated out of the Venville Centre. So it's just a bit of history that now we've added to Lois. It was only in the 1990s. There's a fellow called Ken Main. He ran, and he had a relation or a great uncle, a fellow called Paddy Dunn, who established a, he thought he had a dairy, but when we find through early peninsular records, he actually had a market garden, and I didn't know where he was, and in fact, the peninsula didn't have any records of streets or anything else. They were called Peninsula, Mayland. That's where they were. They were on the peninsula. They had a dairy or a garden or whatever, and it wasn't in Peninsula Road or any of those roads. It was just called Peninsula Mayland. So I said, look, well, I can see where the market gardens were down where, near where the Polars live, Frank and Karen, down the foot of them. Boggathorpe were the Chinese market gardens in that flat area down there. And I said, that's where the market gardens were, where the great relation, the great uncle Paddy Dunn, I'm not sure. But anyway, he was keen to look through all our stuff at the police station, and then he left to go down and try to work out where his great uncle had his property. There was another lad, Barry Bovell. He grew up in Mayland and lived in Peninsula Road. And his older brother Bob and I were mates in the early days when we were young. And he now lives in Manager, but he's very keen to get up to the police station. And the first time he's in Perth on a Wednesday, he'll be in there to see. There was a woman called Ada Law Davies, and she ran for information about an ancestor called Henrietta Mullane. We didn't know anything of Henrietta, so we referred her to Kathy May to see whether she had anything on her. There was another guy, David Hawkes. Now, there was a guy, David Hawkes, worked for the ABC, an announcer, but it wasn't that David Hawkes, although he spoke with a very refined English accent. I can't remember it. But he said, when he was about eight, he was delivering green groceries for some people who had a green grocery business. And he said he used to come to our house, and I had a small yacht, and I took him sailing. Anyway, later on, when he started work, he finished up moving to England, and he still had the urge to go sailing, and he lived in England for most of his working life, but he said he always owned a yacht, and he's back in Perth now, and he lives on a large yacht at Fremantle Sailing Club, but he's dead keen and hasn't been yet, so we're still waiting to see David Hawkes. Now there's a fellow called Max Naylor. Max grew up in Kenilworth Street, and he told us about when Grammack built their new building in Kenilworth Street near where he lived. He's come on two occasions with his wife Jill, and he's done a plan of shops in the sort of in the shopping area with all the names of the people who owned the shops when he could remember, which is really good and important stuff. Some of you remember old Albert Rocha, who had the Gold Mead Dairy. Albert rang, and
I think I'm Rocha Place.
Yeah, that's right.
Yes, you do. Yeah, it was Gold Mead Dairy in Farnham Road.
Yeah.
I dig up horse shoes from his.
Is that right? Horses. Still in your backyard?
That's right. One didn't have one.
Okay. Well, Albert, he came down to the police station. He's over 90, still driving. And he came down and gave us quite a heap of stuff that we now have a file. Suzette, Margaret, and Keith working on these files, and we have an Albert Rocha file of all the days when he had his dairy in the area where now
his favourite horse is called, his favourite horse is called Fatso too.
That's right, we've got a photo of Fatso in the file. But Albert, actually, he said to me, you know, what do you think, you know, I was telling about this fellow Max Naylor, who had given us. Albert's very keen on the history of my own. And I told him about Max Naylor giving us a bit of a sketch of, you know, so and so's Quinny's butcher shop was here and so and so, all these different owners. So anyway, he said, well, look, he said, if you can get a plan, he said, I don't care if it's as big as a table. And he said, you know, I'll give you, he didn't give me the money yet, but anyway, he said, if I can get a big plan drawn up so we can write in all this information about who were in these different shops and so on. He said, I'll give you $300 to buy the equipment, plans, and have a so anyway, I'm working on that. There was a fellow called Greg Horsworth, and he was an ex-policeman. He rang, and he's been out to the police station. He worked there, and he went into the back room and said, oh, there was a sergeant at the time called Bert Hutchins, and he said he tore strips off me in this room. He said he sat me down and he said I was only a young bloke out of the police academy, and he tore strips off me several times in this room as something he'd done wrong. But he brought us a funeral notice of Bert Hutchins, who was his sergeant and whose name appears on the list on our report. There was a woman called Lucy O'Brien. She rang, said she would ring back, left a message, but she hasn't rung back. There was another girl who actually was a friend of our family. She rang because she saw the thing in the paper, but she wasn't so interested in my aims. She just wanted to catch up with the family. There was a young fellow I went to school with called Laurie Winthrop, and I was pleased to talk to him. I went to school with him. His father, Eric, was a great bowler. And of course, the bowling club was in 8th Avenue, just back of the Rose Garden with the hall. And Eric and another chap, who I can't remember his name, but they won, I think it was Scott Marble, they won the state pairs championship in Lawn Bowls 1 year for Maylands. And Laurie's hasn't been yet, but he said he's got photos of his dad and his partner after they won the state fairs, and he's going to bring that along. That'll become part of our history. Oh, there was a girl called Megan. She rang, and she said she would charge me to ring her back. I don't know if anyone knows an older woman called Megan who lived in Maine, but she left me a phone number, but there's one number short. I went over and over this phone call, and I couldn't get enough numbers to
bring up the option to get it.
Yeah?
Alright.
Okay. So then we had a call from a very quietly spoken lady, and her name was Faye Gilhooley, pretty good Irish name, and in fact, she was she was a nun in the Catholic Church. And She came out to the police station. She's 89 years old and she still drives herself. And she gave us some really good photos of this Catholic school in Guildford Road, which is the other side of, like, Perth side of Peninsula Road. It used to be Sonic Hall there. And that's where the first Catholic school was. And she gave us photos of all the kids who were at school in the years that she went there. And she grew up in Crawford Road. Crawford Road, most of you know, doesn't come this side of the railway, so the other side. But in fact, she said she grew up in Crawford Road and told them where it was. But that's not Crawford Road, that's Ferguson Street. Mm. He said, yeah, it was Ferguson Street now, but when she grew up, it was Crawford Road. So we learned a little bit. So then I went back through the street directories, and sure enough, she grew up in Crawford Road, which is now Ferguson Street. That's pretty much all that's happened, and I think we've probably been down long enough anyway, but I just thought it was not a bad idea to sort of keep you up to date on what's happened.